It has been a joy for me to be part of the Calgary community since 1999 when I came here to take up the chair. And I recognize some faces in the audience who have attended many of these lectures in years past. I wasn't around in the fall, I had sabbatical. So we had a couple of events, and I hope some of you found your way to those events, but it's good for me to be back and able to host you this evening. This is actually the fourth event that we've had annually relating to this topic of poverty and homelessness. The first one of these four was 3 years ago, and it was here. And I'm happy to see the gentleman who was our speaker at that time, John Rook, who spoke to us about the issue of homelessness 3 years ago. And then we met at Redeemer Church, Church of the Redeemer. We met at Central United just last year. And then we're again at Grace this evening. Of course, the logic is we want it to be in the city, in the inner city, where these events, of course, these issues are so important and so crucial, these issues of poverty and homelessness. I want to give you just a few facts relating to poverty in Calgary, and that is our focus this evening, dealing with the issue of poverty in Calgary. There are some definitions of poverty. The professor in me, I guess. One of the most concise definitions I've come across is one that says that poverty is about living with a lack of options. And you think of the options that maybe we take for granted in how we spend our income and choices we make. Do we stay in our job, find a new job, and so on. People who live in poverty find their options restricted, and much as they would like to move in new directions, they find themselves inhibited. Poverty is being deprived of the resources, means, choices, power to acquire and maintain independence and to be an active participant in society. Of course, poverty in Calgary has its own special set of issues. When we consider that Calgary is probably the most prosperous city in Canada right now, highest average income in Canada, right here, lowest unemployment rate, at least until a few months ago, that was true. In 2010, in 2010, there were 114,000 Calgarians living below the poverty line. In 2006, this is an interesting statistic, nine neighborhoods in Calgary had a poverty rate of 30% or more of its citizens in that neighborhood. In 2006, two-thirds of the low-income population were working. They're not unemployed, they're actually employed, but nevertheless living in this low-income category. Some of you may know or have heard of the Calgary Poverty Reduction Initiative, a joint project between the City of Calgary, the United Way of Calgary, and area. In 2012, the Calgary Poverty Reduction Initiative undertook some consultations with different stakeholders in Calgary. And those consultations yielded a document and yielded some initiatives and some goals. And among those goals was that by 2018, Calgarians, the City of Calgary, make poverty a high priority. And that by 2023, 95% of Calgarians should be living, this is the goal, above the low income cutoff rate. In January 2015, a change was made in the pursuit of this Calgary Poverty Reduction Initiative so that a four-year agreement was undertaken between the city, United Way, Vancouver, Momentum, and the Calgary Poverty Reduction Community Initiative was moved to the Vibrant Communities of Calgary. There was that organizational shift. Vibrant Communities Calgary, and we're pleased to have Darrell Howard representing Vibrant Communities with us this evening, works with various stakeholders and partners in Calgary to engage Calgarians with issues of poverty, to advocate for strategies that address the roots of poverty in our city. I don't want to go on for too long. I do want, of course, to introduce our panelists. In my position where I'm organizing events, it's always nice when you contact somebody that you think would be great for an event, and they say yes. And I'm happy to say that I didn't have to twist any arms, that Jeff and Derek and Darrell were enthusiastic to take part this evening, and I'm grateful for that. First of all, Derek Cook, who's in the middle and will be speaking first, comes to us with over 20 years of experience in social work and community development. We just discovered over this evening that we come from the same community, Kitchener-Waterloo in Ontario, so just made that discovery now. We both saw the light and moved to Calgary. Prior to his work with Calgary Poverty Reduction Initiative, Derek had a senior research position as a social planner with the City of Calgary. He conducted social research, trend analysis, and policy development. He has worked as a community development worker, and he is a social worker. He has spent time as a social worker. He has degrees from McGill and the University of Guelph. And then next to Derek is Darrell Howard. She is a community facilitator with Vibrant Communities Calgary. She has worked in the nonprofit sector and public sector for over 20 years as well. She began her career with the Development Disabilities Resource Center. She's worked with individuals with developmental disabilities, businesses, organizations, and neighborhoods to promote inclusive communities. She has managed volunteer programs and developed public education programs. Jeff Loomis is director of Momentum, an organization dedicated to community economic development. He's been director just since June, so less than a year in that position. He was in the position as an associate role prior to that, for a number of months prior to that. Jeff has a experience, in, of course, in working with Momentum. What's Momentum? I'm sure Jeff will tell us. But it's devoted to small business training, micro business loans, courses and personal money management, and I discovered that they've invested more than $1.6 million in various program initiatives, which is very impressive. Previously, Jeff was a senior community planner with United Way in Calgary. Jeff has degrees from University of Calgary, a wise choice, and both in political science and environmental design. So as you can see, we have a wealth of wisdom and experience and background to address this issue this evening. The way I've framed our issue is poverty in Calgary, issues, challenges, and strategies. And that's pretty much all the instruction I gave our panel. They're going to speak out of their own experience. So welcome, and we'll start with Derek.
Good evening, and thank you for the privilege of sharing some thoughts with you this evening. It's an honor to be invited to speak and to have the chance to reflect on some of my work over the years. I asked when Doug got in touch with me to ask if I'd like to speak, how theological he wanted this to be, given that it is a lecture in theology. He said, well, as theological as you want. So I'm not trained in theology, but I think that faith has certainly informed my work over the last 20 years as I've been engaged in social justice work. So I just want to share some of my thoughts and reflections. As I've worked through some of these struggles myself in my own faith journey, so you're in a church and I'm in a pulpit, so here we go. And what I wanted to reflect on tonight was what I'm thinking may be a rather provocative question, which is why Jesus didn't talk very much about the poor. which may seem odd. Because for many people, the Christian faith and poverty are deeply interconnected, and acts of charity are widely viewed as one of the hallmarks of the Christian life. The church itself has a long history of providing relief and advocating for justice for the poor. So it's rather puzzling then, when we delve into the Gospels, to find out that Christ himself had actually very little to say about poverty or the poor. And most of what he did say is actually rather troubling to people like myself who have made a life of trying to do something about it. In reading through the Gospels, there are, in fact, only five principal references to the poor, and only one of those actually admonishes anyone to do anything about it, and that's when Jesus tells the rich young man to sell what he has and give it to the poor, which seems like it has much more to do with the plight of the young man's soul than it does with the plight of the poor. The other times Jesus mentions the poor, he tells us that the poor are blessed. While the recounting of the poor widow putting her coins in the collection box praises the faith of the poor, but doesn't really say anything about the condition of poverty itself. In the most direct reference to the poor, Jesus actually admonishes the charitable zeal of his disciples and reminds them and us that the poor will be with you always. So when at some point John's disciples come to Jesus and say, John's asking about you, what should I tell him? And Jesus says, well, tell him that the good news is proclaimed to the poor. We're kind of left wondering, well, what good news could that possibly be? So although in reading through the gospel you find little reference to the poor or poverty, the gospels are full, however, of Jesus in his role as a healer. So the word poor, if you count through the Gospels, only appears 25 times in all four Gospels combined. The word heal or healing appear 93 times. Now, healing and poverty might seem like they're very distinct things until you look at who it was that Jesus was healing. And the ones who Jesus was healing were predominantly those who were referred throughout the Bible almost synonymously with the poor, those being the widow, the fatherless, the alien, and the afflicted. What did it mean in biblical society to be widowed or alien or fatherless or afflicted? It really meant to be outside of the structures of family and community that sustained people. It meant to be excluded. So when Jesus healed, there was a profound social dimension to this healing, as it involved intentionally engaging with those people that society had shunned. So where others shunned, Jesus entered into a relationship. So the act of healing itself was a statement of the value that he placed on those that society chose to exclude. So the impact of that healing was also deeply social. When he healed a person with leprosy, he didn't simply treat the disease. He restored the person to their community. And when he healed a person who was blind or lame, he restored to them the ability to actively participate in community life before there were such things as Social Security and disability benefits. So healing then did more than just repair the body. It brought people back inside the shelter of their community. And since those that Jesus was healing were also those most often thought of as poor, Jesus' ministry of healing is a ministry of the poor. And it gives us a glimpse of maybe a new way of thinking about and understanding poverty. Because the real healing that took place was not so much the healing of the body as it was a healing of the broken relationships within community that led to poverty in the first place. If we look at poverty from this lens, poverty isn't so much a problem to be fixed. We like to fix stuff, and we look at poverty as something we have to fix, we have to solve it. But poverty isn't a problem to be fixed, it's a wound to be healed. Poverty separates, poverty isolates. Poverty engenders guilt, shame, and accusations. It creates fear and helplessness. Through our work with the Poverty Reduction Initiative, we held some workshops and we asked people to describe what poverty was, what it felt like. And one of the participants in one of those workshops described it this way. She said, poverty is emptiness, destitute, hopelessness, helplessness, sadness, darkness, lost, no identity, no self-esteem, coldness, ashamed, no voice, no family, no grandchildren, no smiles, no privacy, no laughter, no happiness. This is what living in poverty means. You'll notice she made no mention of money. What she did talk about was broken relationships, isolation, and the pain that accompanies that. She didn't describe a problem. She spoke about a wound in the fabric of our community. And if poverty is a wound in the fabric of our community, it is a wound that we're all part of because we're all part of the community, so we're all wounded. This is the wound that we experience first in our eagerness to disconnect from community. As we idealize the value of independence, we idolize a self-made man or a woman. When we do that, we see ourselves and each other as competitors in a game of scarce resources where we must fight for our share. And when we buy into that notion, the notion of scarcity, we fail to acknowledge God as a sustainer and source of our abundance. And so too, when we buy into this myth of self-reliance, we willingly deny the reality that none of us have done it by ourselves. We're all interdependent, not independent, existing within the bonds of community, humbly dependent on God and each other. We experience this wound in how we define ourselves. Rather than viewing each other as children of God with inherent dignity and rights and respect, we've come to view ourselves and each other as consumers, defined by our willingness and ability to consume. Somehow shopping has become a civic duty, and our economic health and the health of our community seems dependent on our ability to continue to consume more and more. This need to consume leaves us working long hours at the expense of family and community and hopelessly in debt. And those who can't consume, who can't keep up, get left behind, excluded. This brokenness appears in how we categorize each other and how eager we are to do that. We talk about the poor as though they're a separate species. Once we label people, it's easy to see them as something other than us, and then we can easily assign blame and deny rights. It's easy to see the question of poverty as a competition between the poor and the non-poor, between us and them, between the deserving and the undeserving, and that further tears at the fabric of our community. We experience this wound in the broken relationships that we have with each other. As the bonds of community weaken, more and more people experience social isolation, and I'd say that loneliness is one of the scourges of our modern society. And when we lack close relationships with family, with friends, with neighbors, we're much more vulnerable to spiral into a condition of poverty when things go wrong. And when we're isolated, it's also that much harder to claw your way out of poverty if you find yourself landing there. And so lacking the bonds of community, then, we devise systems, we devise institutions that can care for those who are left behind. I've been working my way through a wonderful book called The Abundant Community by Peter Block and John McKnight, and they call us the incompetent society because we've lost the ability to do the most important functions of caring for each other as families and neighbors, relying instead on systems and services that can be provided by agencies or purchased in the marketplace. We have depersonalized even the most intimate aspects of our lives. And these, then, are the deep wounds of community that are at the root of poverty and that diminish us all. The wounds of disconnectedness, of depersonalized relationships that allow us to define and relate to each other as something other than the children of God, worthy of dignity and respect. And these are the wounds in need of healing, and of which poverty is just a symptom. Ultimately, poverty is about power. As I mentioned previously, the ones that are referred to as the poor throughout the Bible are those who found themselves, for whatever reason, on the fringes of society. They were excluded from power and excluded from community life. And if we think about the world today, it's actually not that dissimilar. If you look at who is actually poor in Calgary, who experiences poverty most, it's lone parent families or people without families. It's Aboriginal persons dispossessed of their land. It's recent immigrants and temporary foreign workers. And it's persons with disabilities. In short, the widow, the alien, the afflicted, and the fatherless. Those who are also largely excluded from our own structures of power and support. Now, in the Old Testament, there were laws and institutions that were developed to keep power imbalances in check. There was the practice of Jubilee, where the poor were released from their debts every 7 years and were allowed to reap from the fallow fields. There was also a practice of requiring people to leave some of their harvest behind to allow others to come and reap and glean where the harvest was left. So in this way, social justice became embedded in the very institutions of the Jewish state. And we've embedded similar institutions in our society. We have labor laws, we have minimum wages, we have Social Security, we have Medicare paid for by a more or less progressive tax system. We have rules and systems in place that allow us to direct our charitable contributions to organizations that will take care of people. And we have programs and services supported by public and private funds that are available for people when they need them. We also have obligations under international law to protect the social and economic rights of people. And all of these institutions and all of these laws and structures are good. But our stumbling block is that I believe we've let these systems substitute for deep and nurturing human relationships. We no longer need to concern ourselves with the welfare of our neighbors because we've got programs and services to do that. We no longer need to concern ourselves with the welfare of our employees, as we have systems that will take care of that. We no longer need to provide caring and support in person, as we can provide a charitable contribution instead to the charity of our choice and get a tax receipt. And we've turned our compassion into transactional relationships mediated by governments and institutions. We've truly become consumers and taxpayers instead of citizens and neighbors. So we can, in good conscience, walk around the homeless person on the street because we've given our charitable donation to the mustard seed. We can walk around the Samaritan because there's someone tasked with looking after that person for us. All we have to do is call, if we will. Except that Jesus doesn't let us off the hook that easily. Because Jesus makes it personal. Jesus says, I was a stranger, I was naked, I was hungry, I was in prison, and you didn't visit, clothe, or feed me. Because for Jesus, it's all about the relationship. In Jesus, we're confronted with a human dimension that reminds us that we're all connected to each other in relationships for which laws and institutions are no substitute. Not that there's anything wrong with the systems and institutions we've developed. In fact, that really embodies the justice that the prophets in the Old Testament called us to. And Jesus never suggested that they were in any way wrong, but he did say that, he hasn't come to replace the law. Those things are good, but he's come to fulfill it. To fulfill it by restoring the broken relationships that require those laws and institutions in the first place. This begins the process of healing rather than fixing poverty, because fixing poverty views it as a problem that we must solve. It must be defined, it must be analyzed, solutions must be planned, most likely by an expert. We'll research best practices, we'll create logic models, we'll identify outcomes, mobilize resources, and we'll monitor and evaluate results. We'll treat people as objects to be manipulated with interventions rather than as human beings in need of dignity and respect. And in short, it will reinforce the systems and structures that have come to substitute for genuine human compassion and relationship. When we see poverty as a problem to be fixed, the solution itself begins to reinforce the very causes of poverty by further entrenching the distinction between us and them, between the poor and the non-poor, by defining and labeling people as poor, and establishing a power relationship between the helper and the helped. When Jesus healed, though, he upset the power dynamic between the powerful and the weak. Because for Jesus, it wasn't about devising impersonal systems or fixing things. For Jesus, healing was a very personal activity that almost always involved him establishing a relationship with the person being healed. It usually involved a conversation with the person. It usually involved the consent and faith of the person seeking healing, and there was some form of physical connection, and often at the end, there was some act of restoration with the community. Healing involved a reciprocity and a breaking down of the power imbalances that kept people in poverty. Now, while Jesus didn't say much about poverty in the Gospels, he did have a whole lot to say about power. And the Beatitudes speak directly to what some people have called the upside-down kingdom, where the first become the last and the last become the first, where the powerless are the powerful, where those who believe they have the solutions are left speechless, while the healer and the healed enter into a new relationship of reciprocity and respect, and the weak are restored to the shelter of community life. What does this then suggest about how we should go about healing? I just want to close with a few reflections on what this means for our own practice. First, I believe that when we approach poverty as something to be healed rather than fixed, it challenges us to alter not only how we see others, but also how we see ourselves. When we stop talking about fixing poverty and begin talking instead about healing it, we come to realize that we all suffer from the wounds of broken community and we're all vulnerable. When we come to this place, we can move beyond the solutions that allow us to categorize people and establish power relationships over them in the guise of healing. Rather, we can establish authentic healing relationships where both healer and healed experience the need and effects of healing. Secondly, if we approach it in this way, how we do what we do becomes as important as what it is that we do. Do the systems and the interventions that we devise, are they in the guise of helping? Do they really establish authentic human relationships based on reciprocity? Or do they further depersonalize and stigmatize? And we're challenged to think about how we can repersonalize the relationships that and institutions that the market and our systems have depersonalized. How can we reclaim them and turn them into authentic relationships? This challenges us to think about our relationships with each other in all aspects of our public and private lives. Challenges us to think about how our choices as consumers affect the rights of others, about the impact of our decisions in our workplaces on our workers. How does our obsession with lower taxes impact those with the least power? And finally, I think this view leads us to a place where power is central. The goal of any healing work must be to restore the wholeness of community by actively including those who are excluded. While there is an important role here for institutional justice, it is also a deeply personal endeavor. We must ask ourselves, how are we actively including vulnerable people in our workplaces, in our communities, in our churches, in our places of worship? How are we, in fact, including those with the least power in the decisions that are affecting them? Are we, in fact, willing to become vulnerable by giving up power and control to new voices who may not have previously been at the table? Only when we can start to answer these questions do we begin to address the challenge of including the excluded that is at the root of poverty. Only then can we begin to move beyond the many distinctions between us and them and start to reestablish the broken bonds of community that lie at the heart of poverty and that diminish us all. So perhaps the reason that Jesus didn't talk very much about the poor is because Jesus didn't divide the world into categories. He didn't divide the world into poor and non-poor. He didn't make any distinctions between us and them, because in the end, it's not about the poor. In the end, it's about the relationships that we nurture amongst each other as family members, as neighbors, as employers and citizens. And if we're truly committed to seeing every one of us as children of God, all equally loved and equally vulnerable, all equally in need of God's grace, and equally reliant on God and each other, this will lead us to see and treat each other with dignity and respect. And when we come to this healing place, we'll have begun relating to each other in ways that don't allow poverty to take root and flourish. We'll still have our laws and institutions and programs and systems that provide support and execute justice. They will no longer be the substitutes for the mercy and compassion that we are called to. We will have found the trust that allows community to flourish and in which we find resilience, and it's through that resilience that we can begin to mobilize the abundance that's around us. And this is the good news that Jesus proclaimed to the poor, which, in the end, it turns out, is every single one of us. Thank you.
Well, I think I've said it before to Derek that I could just listen to him all day long. So I don't know what you're doing after this, Derek, but, you know, me and you. Okay, thanks. My name is Darrell Howard, and I'm both thrilled and terrified, actually, to be up here. Thrilled because it's a real privilege to have this opportunity. I'm going to see if this joke works. Any students? Yes. Doug said there wouldn't be any. You can't hear me?
No.
Okay, well, let's try this one. Is that all right? That's better? Okay, look at me being really loud now. So, back to the students. So, Doug told me that I had 20 minutes to be up here to talk, and I'm currently also a student right now, and as it happens, a 20-minute speech is the same as a 2,500-word paper. So I'm hoping that I can actually turn this in for my next assignment, so we'll see how that goes. This is also terrifying. I've only worked with Vibrant Communities Calgary for about 2 years now, and so I'm no expert on poverty, and I'm glad that Derek shared with us that you don't have to be an expert to make a difference. So my personal experience with poverty is pretty mild when I think of all the people I've met through the years. Nonetheless, I'm excited to be here and to have this opportunity. So as Doug mentioned, I work for Vibrant Communities Calgary, and we're now shepherding the Calgary Poverty Reduction Initiative's Enough for All strategy that was masterfully constructed through the leadership of Derek Cook. I'm only going to touch on lightly about my work at VCC, because Doug kind of gave us license to talk about our own experience, so hopefully I'll weave my own experience with the people I've met through the years into what I'm saying tonight. So there were four words I heard a lot as a kid. We can't afford it. Anyone else hear those words? Yeah, we heard those words a lot. It seemed to be the answer for everything. So as a kid, I paper routed, I bottle picked, and I babysat my way to the things I wanted, a fish tank, a bike, and as a teenager, a trip to France. That's just how it was for us. My family emigrated from England in 1975 when I was six. My parents were not educated. My mom made it to grade eight, my dad less than that. He was a bricklayer back in England. Not many brick buildings here in Alberta, so work was tough. But they did find jobs, albeit low-paying jobs. My parents bought a mobile home, and the six of us, I have three older brothers, settled into Canadian life. While my brothers remember never having enough food, we always had three meals a day. We didn't have fancy clothes, In fact, I was quite indignant about wearing the neighbor's hand-me-down underwear. Two of my older brothers were constantly in trouble, and I remember my dad warning them, "They'll send us back to England." That's probably why I was such a good kid. We had two dogs, we went camping, and I learned to skate. It was the Canadian thing to do. In fact, I still skate. Not right now, because I'm a student and working, so it's impossible to skate. So through the years, my family, my parents chased the great Canadian life. And unfortunately, in doing so, they racked up a lot of debt. "We can't afford it" had a second part, but we have credit. Now, at 75 and 86, my parents are still in debt. And quite frankly, it's the only kind of, the only way they're going to get out of that debt is if they die or if they sell their home. It's the only way. When I think of my childhood, I can't help but think of families who are homeless today here in Calgary. I imagine they're a lot like mine, yet the threat of homelessness was never a thought of us, nor was there ever a real need to access a food bank. I don't know that there really was any back then. I grew up in a rural town, there wasn't one, there wasn't any then. We had enough to meet our basic needs. Even later, when my dad lost his job and my mom's work hours were cut, we could get by. We had safety nets and other favorable conditions that kept us afloat. The biggest wound of my childhood? Being called trailer trash. Trust me, I have never watched an episode of the Trailer Park Boys. And so I think of those kids whose homes are shelters. What must it be like for them? What is the stigma that they have to walk around with? Doug asked me to suggest what's been successful in fighting poverty, and so let's take a look at the conditions that existed for my parents those many years ago. First, from the 1977s through to the mid-90s, income equality rates in Canada were much lower than they are today. It's likely that low-income earners had enough to make ends meet. Since the 70s, though, the average income of the poor has only grown marginally. So if you look at the stagnation of income in the poorest members of our community and compare that to our present-day cost of living, you can start to see why families struggle. My parents were able to meet our family's basic needs because they earned enough. They weren't burdened by school fees. I had three older brothers who babysat me, not that well, I have the scars to prove it. We grew some of our own food, and we had numerous connections in our community. For years, and this still happens, friends supply my dad with wood for the fireplace, and that's what keeps the trailer warm over the winter months, still to this day. Those connections have always helped. So what about that family at the Inn from the Cold? What might prevent them from ever needing to access such a service in the first place? Well, let's start by ensuring that people earn at least a living wage, a wage that means low-income earners make enough to meet their basic needs. So shelter, food, clothing, transportation, childcare, school fees. I don't think that's a lot to ask for. Calgary's living wage is $17.29 an hour. So Alberta's minimum wage would need to increase by about 69% to be a living wage. That's a huge and drastic difference. So if you are an employer, I invite you to strive to pay at least a living wage. If you do, and I'll put in the plug for VCC, sign up for our Living Wage Leader Program. It provides you with some exposure, and it helps us advocate for wages that truly enable people to meet their basic needs. Now, when VCC and United Way calculated Calgary's living wage, we discovered that a family with two children could spend as much as 27% of their income, you're going to say housing, on childcare. So many families in Alberta can't access the child care subsidy because there aren't enough registered child care spaces. So in a Herald, in an article in the Herald, they describe a 200-person waiting list for one registered center and lists that include unborn children. So parents are really wise to this, and they're getting on it. So we need to tackle child care in Alberta. What would accessible, affordable public child care look like? What could we learn from other provinces? And what could we learn from the many different initiatives that have come out of the Enough for All strategy? And I see Sarah here with, she does some co-op work, and I know child care co-ops is something that's come up. So a great alternative. So as I said before, our family had enough to meet our basic needs, but that little bit more came at a cost. It's a lifetime of debt that still hangs around my parents' neck. Having financial literacy skills and being able to build financial assets would have made a huge difference for them, and it would have for me, because in my 20s, I took up their spending habits and I found myself in a lot of debt. So today, instead of struggling to pay down debt, my dad could fly home to England and visit his ailing sister. He could replace the dilapidated truck he's been driving since 1989. They wouldn't be at risk of losing their home, their mobile home, when the next big bump comes, the next big bump in the road. And it's actually hit. Financial empowerment has the real power to prevent and reduce poverty. And Jeff is going to say a little bit more about that, so I'll leave it there. So I want to go back to our immigrant experience. When I was young, a classmate went on a rant about how immigrants are taking over. They're taking Canadian jobs, they're destroying the company, so on and so forth. It was awful. And so I responded. I said, "I'm an immigrant. Is that how you feel about me?" "Oh no, I don't mean you. You're like us." This was my earliest understanding of discrimination, of racism, and of my own privilege. I am a white immigrant. I speak fluent English, and my accent gives little evidence of where I arrived from, unless, of course, I'm around my family, and then it sort of starts to sneak up on me. So if we really want to reduce poverty in our city and our province, we need to be brave enough to tackle systemic barriers that can cause racism or can cause poverty. Things like racism, classism, ableism, ageism, homophobia. You get the picture. My friend Zaid, who emigrated with his family from Pakistan roughly 15 years ago, has had a very different immigration experience than me. Even though he's done all he can to chase what Marinenci calls the great Canadian life. He started volunteering with me when I used to work for the city. He was excellent. He wanted to gain Canadian experience. He readily took low-paying jobs to make ends meet. He took English upgrading courses, and when employers told him they couldn't hire him because of his foreign credentials, he went and got a Canadian degree. He's got 3 kids. So where did that get him? Well, unfortunately, he's still working low-paying jobs, and he's still trying to chase down a job suited to his education, work that will sustain him and his family. His efforts are yet to pay off. He's even had to lodge a human rights complaint against a former employer. He also swears that when an employer sees his resume and they assume he's Muslim, they trash it. Whether that's true enough to think that way must be devastating. How resilient must he be? And what is our role in changing Zaid's experience? I think we have one. How can he realize the great Canadian life through the merits of his hard work without unnecessary barriers? My immigrant family had it so much easier. 2 summers ago, before I started working with VCC, I agreed to help a friend of mine with his job search. Because my friend has a developmental disability, we took a different approach. We were upfront with potential employers about David's special needs and how supportive employment works for both David and the employer. Many businesses gave David's resume thoughtful consideration, but they couldn't offer him a position. Unfortunately, two businesses stood out for their blatant discrimination. A small business and a highly regarded retailer with a superior reputation of being a good corporate citizen. It was devastating telling David's mom, also a good friend of mine, what was said about her son. A man with many, many, many gifts. Last summer and fall, I had the privilege of working with Poverty Talks on the We Act project. It was a project aimed at building connections amongst people living in poverty and their allies to tackle poverty-related issues in our community. From the many involved, there were 14 people who presented at the We Act Powered by Pachacacha event on International Day to Eradicate Poverty. So if anyone hasn't seen a Pachacacha, it's a 6 minute and 40 second presentation with slides that go by 20 seconds and you're done right on time. So Pam Beebe, who is an Aboriginal woman, was one of those presenters. She spoke about what racism means to her. Now if you have a chance, go onto VCC's website, go to the blog page, and you can find a link to her presentation. It's powerful. I've seen it many times, and it still makes me shiver. So the day after Pam's presentation, I was amongst a group of people who were asked an important question. What breaks your heart? What breaks your heart? Knowing that Pam has faced discrimination and racism in every phase of her life breaks my heart. Knowing that systemic discrimination is one of the root causes of poverty should break all of our hearts, and it should call us to action. Pam's closing remarks were this: recognize your own biases, racist thoughts, and stereotypes, and please, please, please be kind to each other no matter what. Preventing poverty is within all of us. If we want to make radical change, if there is enough for all, and if our neighbor's strength is our strength, then we need to ensure that no one gets pushed to the margins. No one is pushed to poverty simply because of who they were born, the place they were born, the color of their skin, their health or disability status, who they love, the gender they become, or the place they worship. It's easier than you think. David, my friend, happens to be surrounded by a network of friends who share his love for the outdoors. I'm one of them. I happen to have a friend or two in the activist community. I think there's a couple here. When one of my activist friends caught wind of David's, of how David was treated at one of the businesses, she sprang to action. She started by writing a letter. When their letter went unanswered, she went to the store to talk to the owner. When the owner responded with more discrimination, she vowed to never shop there again, and to tell her many, 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 many friends about David's experience. She also reflected on her own needs. She had a garden that she couldn't keep up with anymore, and David's a guy who likes physical work. So what did she do? She hired David, and he spent one day of a week doing her gardening. So I went with him, and we were out there when it was raining, when was threatened, lightning was about to happen, he was committed. So I was also extremely upset with how David had been treated by the large retailer. So I wrote a letter to its corporate board of directors. Now, before sending this letter off, I shared it with David's mom. She shared it with David's outdoor community, and it was on. People wrote their own letters. They posted to the company's Facebook page, and they likely went into the store to give them a piece of their mind. David's community shared his hurt. They did not allow him to be pushed to the margin. David and Mark got an official apology letter from the board of directors. I got a meeting with the store manager, and we got a commitment from the company to implement its own policy around inclusive employment practices. David and Mark were done, though. They never went back. Several months later, someone from David's outdoor community called Mark. There was a possible job opening at her company, a terrific match for David. The story has a happy ending. When Bev, the nun I used to work with, defended my right to marriage, she would not allow me to be pushed to the margins. When I look out the window from work and I see the rainbow flag flying over the Hillhurst United Church, or when I walk into the Unitarian Church and I see my brothers and sisters from the LGBT community, I know I have a spiritual home if I ever want or need one. If the family of the next kid who comes out belongs to an affirming church, then perhaps he or she will find a home in faith rather than on the streets. This is powerful poverty prevention in action. Being an ally and walking beside our friends, our neighbors, people like Zaid, Pam, David, or myself is an incredible, powerful act. And we can all make them. It doesn't require special skills or a lot of time. It only requires us to be human, to act with respect, with empathy, justice, and in Pam's words, kindness. So in closing, despite what we hear about our economy, there is no better time to end poverty in Calgary than now. We have a local poverty reduction strategy with people, organizations, business, local government, and faith communities all working together. And I see some of you from who have been a part of the Hub workshops, which is great to see you. So we're all working towards a common vision where all Calgarians are able to meet their basic needs, are able to be a part of community life. We have evenings like tonight, and so many other ways that we are coming together to create change in our community. To me, we are creating a Calgary where no one is pushed to the margins, no one is pushed to poverty, a place we can all share in the great Calgarian life. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. As you heard, my name is Jeff Loomis, and I work at an organization called Momentum, and I want to talk to you tonight about how poverty is not only about money, but it's always about money. So to kind of get our brains going a bit, is I'm going to ask you a few questions about money. So who here has a monthly or annual budget, by show of hands? Okay. Who here has a checking account at a bank or a mainstream financial institution like First Calgary Financial? So almost everyone, okay? Who here has an RRSP or a TFSA, so a registered savings account? Okay, almost all of us. And who here has enough savings in an easily accessible emergency account that would allow you to get by for 3 months if you had no other income coming in? So we're a pretty financially empowered group. One other question, we'll see if anyone would be brave enough to answer this. Who here has ever used a payday loan.
Ever used a what?
A payday loan. So gone to a Money Mart or a cash store. Yeah, there we go. So we're a pretty financially empowered group in this room. So those are some of the topics that I want to talk about, of how money is really an important part of poverty. So first, just to introduce myself a little bit, is, as I said, my name's Jeff Loomis, and I'm a very stereotypical WASP, so white, Anglo-Saxon, Protestant, so feel a little bit at home here. I come from a pretty privileged background, and I have reaped a lot of benefits because of that, economically, socially. I'm essentially kind of part of the power structure as a white male in Canada. However, I am about two generations removed from poverty. My grandparents, my grandfather was a coal miner and worked his way through to eventually get an education, which then opened the door to a more financially prosperous life that then I still feel that I reap the benefits of that to this day, because I now live in my grandfather's house in Calgary, who has since passed away. So that's a little bit about me. And then in terms of momentum, where I work, I work for an organization that's very committed to working with people on lower incomes to increase prosperity and also creating economic conditions so that more people can experience prosperity. And so as you heard, we use economic development tools primarily to do that, to increase prosperity. So tools like microloans. And I'll talk to you a little bit about some of the financial empowerment work that we do and are trying to build on that Darrell referenced. So at Momentum, we fundamentally believe that to really reduce poverty, we have to talk about two key things, both related to money, and they're income and assets. So when we often think about poverty, we think about income, how much you earn, and that is critically important. But we also need to talk about assets. So if you think about from a personal standpoint, it's both about your earnings and then your balance sheet. Both sides are really critical. So at Momentum, we have been in Calgary. We're a Calgary-based organization, community organization. We have been in existence since 1991. We work with about 4,000 Calgarians a year living on lower incomes. We have a staff team of about 50 people. We receive financial support from all three levels of government, the United Way, local businesses, and many generous donors that support us as well. So we really feel we're supported by the community. So just to tell you a bit more about what I want to talk about is, number one, is go into a bit more about how reducing poverty is about income and assets. So I want to talk more about the income and assets. Secondly, I want to talk about how, or I will talk about how scarcity makes it very difficult for people living in poverty to avoid debt and save for the future. So talk about that issue of scarcity. And lastly, identify opportunities for people living in poverty to become financially empowered and what you can do to be part of those opportunities. So I believe that all of us want to live a good life, have hope for our future, and have hope for the future of those that we love. And I really believe that building financial assets, some of the things we talked about when I asked the questions at the beginning, like savings, RRSPs, savings for your future, RESPs, saving for your children, or home ownership, can have a big impact on our path through life. And there's a quote that I want everyone to be able to reflect on. I believe this is a really important quote to think about the issue of poverty, and it's that without an income, we can't get by, but without assets, we can't get ahead. So without making enough money, it's very hard to get by on a daily, weekly, monthly basis and make your cash flow. Without assets, you can't get ahead and start thinking about the future, plan for the future, and hope and dream about where you can go. So we really believe that to address poverty in a sustainable way, a long-term way, that we have to think about how the lack of assets and the ability to save are critically important. So if you reflect on that quote, without an income, you can't get by, without an asset, you can't get ahead. What is the first problem with that statement? It's that you need income. So a lack of income is the first fundamental problem with poverty. So there's too many people in Alberta that just do not earn enough money, whether that's from a job or whether that's from a public benefit such as AISH, which is Alberta Assisted Income for the Severely Handicapped, to just get by. And over the last 20 years in Alberta, the percentage of people living on low incomes has remained very steady. Regardless of our economic booms, it's at pretty much rock steady at 12% over the last 30 years. So an Albertan currently earning the minimum wage and working 40 hours a week for 50 weeks a year, so only taking 2 weeks off, earns under $20,000. So that is actually almost $3,000 below the low-income cutoff, which is a rough measure of poverty. We also know that in Alberta, 35% of people that are between the ages of 25 and 44, so the prime working age, are earning $15 an hour or less. So I think what some of these stats reflect is that poverty is not only about just getting a job. So that myth of just get a job and then poverty is over is far from true. Really, it's about having a job that can actually enable anyone to earn enough money to pay for their basic living expenses, stay out of debt, and then ultimately save for the future. So that's our first problem, is not enough income. Second key problem, if you think of the second part of the quote, which is the assets allow you to get ahead, Canadians have a lot of debt, and more than ever before. And the debt is actually across the income spectrum, but debt has a much more significant impact, a disproportionate impact on people living on lower incomes. So our debt-to-income ratio in Canada is actually now over 150%. That's one of the highest in all of G7 countries. And regardless of income, many Canadians still have little or no savings or actual assets. So nearly one in four Canadians have no financial wealth at all, and that would include savings, stocks, RRSPs. And there's also research that indicates that just over 50% of Canadians would be considered asset poor. So why I asked about an emergency savings that can last for 3 months is asset poor is when you would not have enough savings to survive above the poverty line for 3 months without employment or another source of income. So asset poverty, which is never really talked about, we primarily talk about income poverty in Canada, is pretty alarming. And those lack of assets, so not having those savings, contributes to the cycle of poverty. It can create somewhat of a poverty trap. Asset poverty puts us in a precarious and vulnerable position where any one little emergency can send us into a downward spiral, could send anyone into a downward spiral. So events like losing a job or having a mental health crisis could then be very difficult to overcome financially and then create a trap. And it's often the people that are living on the lowest incomes that do not have the savings, have the highest level of debt, and are not then able to cushion themselves from a financial shock. So one particular example where people struggle with really bad debt that I want to talk a bit more about is the issue of payday loans. That's why I asked, has anyone had an experience with payday loan? So for people that don't know, a payday loan is a very small, usually under $1,000 loan, short-term loan to cover expenses. The majority of payday loan customers are those that are employed full-time but are earning less than $30,000. So, and they're typically actually male, between the ages of 18 and 34 in Canada. Payday loans typically cost 400% interest when annualized. 400%. So that's arguably a modern-day form of usury. They're often called predatory lending for a reason. Payday loans also focus very much on repeat customers. So a payday loan is not just for a one-time, I'm in a cash crunch, I get a loan to pay my bills. Research shows that there's actually 15 return customers for every new customer at a payday loan outlet, and that the average customer takes between 8 to 12 loans a year. There's also evidence that 75% of the loans taken are used to pay a previous loan, so you're paying off previous debt. So it's a debt trap. Stuck in a debt trap. There's also been a remarkable growth of the payday loan industry across North America. Money Mart, which is one of the larger payday loan chains in Canada, almost doubled over a five-year period from 2004 to 2009. And there's actually more payday loan outlets in the United States than there are Burger King and McDonald's outlets combined. So now, it leads to the question, if there's so much growth, there's obviously a demand for that product. Why would there be a demand for a product where the interest rate is 400% when annualized? Not a good loan product. So there's a few key reasons that payday loans are used. One is there's a lack of customer awareness or knowledge around some of those challenges, the interest rates being one. When Darrell mentioned lack of financial literacy, that is an issue. Two is bank products and services do not always work very well for people living on lower incomes. So check holds, minimum account requirements can be quite challenging. There's also the fact that the shopping experience at payday loans, research has shown it's actually, they're very customer service orientated. And they make people feel very comfortable, while research also shows that banks are not always the case. It can be a little stuffy. And banks are not always as convenient or as accessible. So you just think of bank hours. It's only in the last few years that some banks are open on weekends, as an example. But the biggest reason, while people living on lower incomes will use a payday loan, is it's easy money to get. So most payday loan customers need money quickly. Living paycheck, you need the money right away. And this is where the concept of scarcity becomes really, really critical. There's a new emerging field that's the psychology of scarcity. There's an absolutely amazing book called Scarcity by two professors. One's a psychologist, one's a behavioral economics professor. And their research shows very clearly that living in poverty makes it much harder to make decisions, because you have much greater level of stress, more distractions, and you're essentially mentally depleted by all the challenges in your life, and that all people, regardless of culture, background, education, would have less cognitive capacity when living in a position of scarcity. So it's not about individual bad choices, it's about the scarcity essentially takes away your cognitive capacity to then make good decisions, which are often long-term orientated decisions. So there's also a TED talk, there's a TEDx talk called Living Under Scarcity that is a very powerful TED talk in terms of how damaging the concept of scarcity can be. So what can we do about it? How can we create opportunities to deal with scarcity and then ultimately to reduce poverty? So first, and this is dealing with the first problem, is we need to create opportunities for people to have more money. Seems pretty simple. If you don't have enough money, if you need enough income to just get by, people need to have more money. So that's what leads to ideas like a guaranteed annual income, paying a living wage, like Darrell mentioned, ensuring that people that are unable to work receive adequate benefits. So AISH in Alberta was raised only 4 years ago, which was actually a very, very positive move. It was probably only actually 2 years ago it was raised, because AISH prior, it still does keep people in poverty, but at least close now to the poverty line. Well, before it was way under the poverty line. So that's the first thing, is just creating opportunities for people to have more money. Second is we need to create and provide opportunities for people to avoid bad debt and then ultimately build their savings. So there's a lot of research that shows that even when people do not have enough money, when they don't earn enough to be out of poverty, they can and do save when provided the opportunity. So building assets, creating those opportunities for people to save, can actually overcome scarcity and some of the challenges of scarcity. And that's because research on assets suggests that it's actually a trampoline effect of assets. Assets provide a cushion to land in times of crisis. And they also provide us the foundation to help us jump back up again. So if a crisis hits, having those savings, that's your cushion so that you don't end up spiraling down. So that's the vital role of an emergency savings account. And assets are more than just stored income. People actually behave and think differently when they actually have assets. So building assets can increase our ability to think about and plan for the future, and that can include taking risks that could pay off, something like starting a small business or going back to school. Building financial assets also provides emotional benefits. So when people have assets, research shows that it increases their confidence and they worry less about money because they're not trapped solely in scarcity. So the benefits of having assets allow us to dream about and then actually work towards achieving our potential. So if building assets is so powerful, then how can we actually work with people living on lower incomes to then build their assets? And this is where the concept of financial empowerment comes in. Financial empowerment is a very promising idea. It was identified in the Calgary Poverty Reduction Initiative strategy that Derek led, and Momentum, with key partners like United Way and the City of Calgary, are now working to explore how we can implement this financial empowerment model that was developed in the United States in the Calgary context. And financial empowerment that's been used in the States is proving to be a very effective and practical approach for people living on lower incomes to actually build their assets. The other good thing with the financial empowerment is it's not all brand new. It's actually very similar to some of the work that Momentum and other community partners have been doing for the last 15 years. But it can create the opportunity for us to scale up and make an even bigger difference with the work that we're doing. So the financial empowerment model, there's a few key elements to it. Some of its history, it was developed in the United States, primarily in New York City, and is now being implemented in 12 cities across the United States. And just in New York City alone, over 25,000 people between 2010 and 2013 participated in a financial empowerment initiative, and that resulted in $2.4 million in savings and almost $15 million in reduced debt. So a pretty measurable and significant difference that was made. The financial empowerment model or approach has five key aspects to the intervention. The first one is financial education and counseling. So that's providing the knowledge and skills for people to actually manage their money more effectively. The second is to provide access to income boosting benefits and tax credits. So some of the benefits that are available, people just access. The third is to enhance consumer protection so that people don't necessarily have to take on or are more protected from taking on bad debt like payday lending. The fourth key pillar is to provide access to safe and affordable financial products, so providing an alternative to things like a payday loan. And the fifth is access to savings. So just briefly, I want to talk about the last two pillars of financial empowerment, so safe and affordable financial products and access to savings. So the first one, access to safe and affordable financial products. Quite simply, it's to provide basic financial services and affordable credit products to provide an alternative to fringe financial products, so payday lending being a really significant example. One result of an initiative in San Francisco, there's a project called Payday Plus, and Payday Plus disperses more than 300 safe, low-cost loans annually as an alternative to a payday loan. In Canada, Van City Credit Union last year launched what's called the Fair and Fast Loan as a competitive product. And we're currently at Momentum working with First Calgary Financial to explore how we could together provide an alternative short-term credit product. So the fifth pillar, and the second one I'll talk about, is the opportunity to build savings and assets. So one of the key tools that's used under this pillar is incentivized savings accounts. So creating an incentive for people on lower incomes to actually be able to save. So this is an example where in Canada we actually have some strength that we can build on. This isn't all about what happens in the US is all great. So one of the key areas of work that we do at Momentum is actually working with people to manage and then save their money, as Darrell referenced. So we have been providing matched savings programs, which are an incentivized savings program, since 2000. And our programs are very similar to the financial empowerment model, and our goal is to try to be able to scale those programs up over the next few years through the work of the Calgary Poverty Reduction Initiative led by VCC. So the matched savings programs, this idea of an incentivized savings programs, are based on the premise that people can earn money while they learn about money. So as someone's learning about financial literacy, we provide a matched savings that then can go towards the purchase of an asset. And that asset could be education for oneself, education for a child, tools for work, or for a business. Some of our participants are able to go on and save for home ownership. So the match amount is typically at a 3-to-1 rate. So for every dollar someone saves, we match it at a 3 ratio rate. And that creates the incentive and acts as a power boost to someone's own savings. So if they put, say, $50 away, we're providing a match of $150. The match money and their savings of the 50 then go towards what they want to purchase, their asset goal, which could be education, as I said, for themselves, all the way up to, for some people, home ownership. So research indicates that the match savings idea, this incentivized savings, can really result in long-term savings behavior. People are learning how to save, creating the opportunity to save, and then it becomes a behavior. So since 2000, over 1,600 Momentum participants have earned over $2.5 million in match savings. So people can save if they have the opportunity to save, even when they really don't have enough money, when they don't have an adequate income. And that match savings has been used to purchase over 2,000 assets, including 125 homes. So that's 125 people that have gone from living on low incomes. I know one homeowner that has gone from living in from the cold with her children in a housing family shelter into Calgary housing and is now a proud homeowner and has been a homeowner for over 3 years. So we have significant opportunities to advance this financial empowerment work provincially and locally. So locally, through the Calgary Poverty Reduction Initiative, it was recommended that financial empowerment could be a key action to achieve the goal of all Calgarians having the income and assets necessary to thrive in our community. We're going to have time for questions after, and I'm almost done. I'll be done right away. So we have a significant opportunity here locally. So I just want to finish with a quick story that illustrates both the challenges of scarcity and the possibility that financial empowerment approaches can provide. So I know a fairly young man who moved here from Africa. He was a new Canadian from Africa. He was living in Calgary, and he was working what could be described as a survival job, a low-wage retail job, trying to get by. And there's actually a pretty good chance that before I knew him, he actually made for me one of those fancy juice things. I'm not going to say the brand name, but you know, it's one of those healthy, fancy juices that I probably bought at one time at Market Mall for myself or my kids. So that was the work he was doing to get by. While he was earning this very low wage, he ended up experiencing homelessness because he could not afford housing, and he ended up couch surfing for a while, and he wasn't able to couch surf forever because his friends kept moving him along because they didn't want this guy hanging out when their girlfriends were coming over. So it wasn't exactly permanent housing for him. He then, at one point, a number of years ago, took out a payday loan because he had an emergency expense, something he didn't plan for. And that was he had to help pay for his mother's hospital bill in Africa. So he needed to send money home to Africa to pay for his mother's health care. That payday loan that he took out that was originally for $600 over a period of 10 months cost him $2,500 in interest and the rollover payment. So he was trapped in that position of scarcity. He ended up hearing about Momentum. He participated in one of our match savings programs where he had the opportunity to learn about money. He learned more about credit, learned more about the Canadian financial system, while also having the opportunity to earn some match savings and how it was actually possible for him to save a little bit of money each month and put a little bit away. And through the power boost of the match savings, he was then able to save for his education. He now has a better job. He's doing much better economically, socially, emotionally. He also has been able to open up an RESP for his child. So now that whole idea of having assets for himself is now getting transferred to the next generation so that his child can have the opportunity to save for the child's education and potentially, ideally, that potential cycle of poverty will be broken. Timothy will be able to not live in poverty and his son will not be able to have to live in poverty. So what can you do to help move forward on some of these financial empowerment initiatives? So three things that you can think about. One is our city council in March is deciding on a notice of motion on payday lending, and so you can let your councillor know that you care about the issue of payday lending. Two, the provincial government is actually responsible for the vast majority of payday lending regulation. And the regulation for payday lending under what's called the Fair Trading Act is up for review this year. So you can let your MLA know. There's going to be an election coming up, so good time to let candidates know as well, that the government of Alberta should reduce the allowable interest rate on payday loans so that the interest rate is at least tightened up. Three, and this is more on the earn money side, the income side, is you can really think about buying from businesses that pay a living wage. So as VCC, from Darrell mentioned, VCC has a list of businesses that pay a living wage. One is just down the street, Community Natural Foods. They've been a living wage leader for over 5 years. And so you can think about the power of your money and how you can support businesses trying to do the right thing. So I'd just like everyone to remember that to reduce poverty, we have to think about that without an income, no one can get by, but without assets, it's impossible to get ahead. Thank you.
Well, thank you, panelists. Some rich food for thought. I know there's already one question here, and hopefully there are some others as well. Do you want to start with your question, sir?
I want to know, are these low-interest loans, are they subsidized?
Yeah, so our match savings programs are supported through a number of financial supporters. So United Way is a major supporter. Some foundations, individual donors. So the matched money that we're able to provide, the programs that we offer are free for people to participate in, to learn about money, and then the match savings comes from a variety of sources. Does that answer the question?
Well, yes, in yeah. a way.
There will be a chance afterwards to follow up as well.
They're not loans. So the match savings programs that I described, they're not loans. So people earn that money, that match savings becomes their money. There's no repayment on that money.
So it's really not low interest loans.
It's not a loan.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Other questions for our panelists?
It seems that the rental sector has been under siege in Canada for the past 30 years. What measures do you, do any of the three of you promote for trying to help renters get ahead? I know there's been talk about rent banks and all sorts of other ideas, but what makes the most sense to you?
I'm gonna go first.
I don't know that there's a magic bullet to the affordable housing issue. One way that we can immediately have an impact on the affordable housing situation is with secondary suites. And that's one where we can take action immediately and locally to let our councillors know that secondary suites, legalizing secondary suites, is an important issue. I think another promising opportunity in the lack of massive increases in federal and provincial funding into the building of social housing is through supporting cooperative housing. And I know there's a lot of interest recently in further development of housing co-ops is a good model. So, and Sarah's been doing really terrific work in that field. So I think there are some interesting avenues that we can go without necessarily having to have massive increases in federal or provincial funding for social housing, although that would, of course, certainly help.
So our work is primarily with renters. So the vast majority of people living on lower incomes that we work with are renters. So like any of our match savings programs is an example, those are for people renting. And it was interesting that you mentioned a rent bank. So we actually used to operate a rent bank for close to 10 years. And what we were finding, and the rent bank that we operated, it provided low interest loans for first month's rent, damage deposit, and arrears, so utility and rental arrears. And what we found was that as debt became an increasing issue over the 2000s, and then when the economic crisis hit in 2008, 2009, the vast majority of people applying for a rent bank loan actually had too high of debt that then giving them a loan would have potentially made the situation worse. So the loan became sort of the wrong tool to address the issue. So I think it really is about increasing the supply of affordable housing, and as Derek said, secondary suites is one of the potentially quicker wins. It's nowhere near the panacea. And I think we have to continue to advocate for funding for social housing. So there's great philanthropic efforts like the Resolve campaign that's being led by the Homeless Foundation to increase affordable housing. But the scale that can be provided through philanthropic dollars is nowhere even close to the scale that could be provided through public dollars. And there's a pretty direct correlation from when social housing funding was essentially withdrawn in the early 90s and our increase in homelessness across Canada.
Okay, yes, Kathleen.
Is James McCarra here?
James here. You know, I think the question is, there's a difference between emergency food assistance and food security, right? And we need emergency food assistance, and the food bank does an amazing job of doing that, and I applaud the work that James does. And we should all, in the absence of other solutions, be trying to support that work. But I think we have to step back and say, well, why do people need to be at the food bank in the first place? And that's where we have to look at a lot of the other issues that we've talked about tonight. The payment of a living wage, most of the people who are accessing the food bank are working. Why is that okay in a city of this great wealth? The other largest group of people who are using the food bank are those who are on social assistance. Social assistance rates were slashed about 20 years ago and haven't been appreciably increased since, which is really unconscionable. So when we start to address those issues, then we start to actually talk about food security as opposed to emergency food assistance. I remember when I started work on the Poverty Reduction Initiative, I went out for coffee with James McCarra, who's the head of the food bank, and he looked at me and said, "Derek, do you want to put me out of business?" And I said, "No, I don't. I don't want to put you out of business. I want to put you out of the business of providing emergency food assistance. And let's transform that into a different kind of business that actually supports a sustainable food system in the city," and I think that's what we need to be working towards. There is some very innovative work that's going on at the City of Calgary. The Office of Sustainability has been doing some interesting work around food security and developing a more sustainable local food system. I also applaud the work of Paul Hughes and Grow Calgary, who is doing some innovative work by reclaiming unused right-of-way land and growing food on it. And right now, fresh produce goes to the food bank. I think there's lots of opportunities for that type of activity to grow and scale to do other types of things too.
I'd just like to add that I think the need to use the food bank is very related to not being able to afford purchasing food. Right, so there's food. Some food is not very affordable, but it still comes down to not being able to afford it. And I think we, as a society, have to remember that the creation of a food bank is still a relatively recent creation in the history of Canada as a country. And so that's where the food bank has its place and role, considering the current context. Should it have a role forever? It didn't. Food banks didn't 50 years ago. And should they 50 years from now? I would say not. So I think it's impossible to separate food security from income security.
I just wanted to add, I'm working. When you look at the social determinants of health, you'll see food security there, but it's not a root cause of poverty. It's a symptom of poverty. And so when you take steps to address the root causes of poverty, then you start to tackle that food security issue. In Toronto, there's a really neat program called The Stop, and it's around food security, and it takes it from all kinds of different levels, from the emergency food to community food sharing, collective kitchens, mass buying, all kinds of different programs, food education, all kinds of different things. And so that might be a really neat model to take a look at.
I'd like to raise a question. How do we get corporations to be good citizens? So many leading corporations in our society survive on part-time labor, who get minimal benefits, not just the Walmarts, but all kinds of restaurants. And so many sectors of our corporate society don't pay a living wage. What do we do about that? Is that a government issue to address that?
I think there's actually tremendous opportunity right now. And there's a very interesting new theory of business or capitalism coming out of some of the business schools in I know MIT, for example, and it's the idea of shared value. And the idea of shared value is that the companies that create long-term value in the community are the ones who will ultimately survive in the marketplace. And I read a very good book, which I recommend to people here, called The New Capitalist Manifesto by a fellow by the name of Umair Haque. And he tells the story of a company that tried to market sustainably harvested tuna. And they felt that people would pay a premium to buy sustainably harvested tuna. They took it to the marketplace and it failed miserably. So nobody would pay the premium. However, another company figured out how to sell sustainably marketed tuna at the same price, and they made a killing. Because people ultimately value those, have those same values. And those companies that generate what they call that shared value are the ones who will have the advantage in the long term. So I think that there is tremendous opportunity, and there's great new thinking around this right now that would suggest that business has a very important part to play. I would also point out to the city of Calgary, we have something called the Sustainable Ethical Environmental Purchasing Policy, which establishes minimum social and environmental performance standards for our contractors. If you want to do business with the city of Calgary, you need to meet those certain minimum standards. And I think that's something that companies can do to drive that change through their supply chain, and maybe one of the most important and meaningful impacts we can have on poverty in the city.
Okay. So I hear you saying that there is a municipal government role in this case that's laying some standards down as well as a financial interest.
A municipal government role in our role as a corporation in the city, and there are other corporations, really good corporate citizens in the city that are also doing that, and there's a great potential for other corporations to do that as well.
I think that business, just like people, are all part of the problem and all part of the solution. So I think we have to remember that. And then I do think the business sector has a huge potential to make a really significant difference. It's a massive lever. And so there's big examples, and in the Calgary Poverty Reduction Initiative, we talk about doing business differently, and we talk about human resource practices, and we talk about potential purchasing, like Derek referenced the cities taking some lead on. And then there's potentially really small things that employers can do that can make a huge difference. So if we think of the issue of payday lending, part of why payday lending has grown as well is that employers used to provide cash advances to employees. So if an employee was in a cash crunch situation, it was very typical that you could go to an employer and say, oh, I need some cash. And now that systems have become so automated, that's much more difficult for many employers to do. And so the cash advance is often done by payday lending. So an employer just being willing to provide cash advantages can make a big difference. Employers setting up automated savings enrollment so that people automatically save, whether it's an RSP or an RESP. That can make a big difference for people then to build assets. So it can be fairly small initiatives as well that can make a big difference. So I think there's a huge opportunity for the business community to be part of the solution.
Question here, yes.
Well, I like the example of in from the cold because, as I was trying to say, how we do what we do is often as or more important than what it is that we do. On the one hand, in from the cold, some people would look at it and say, well, it's not addressing the problem. It's just, we're just sheltering people. We're not addressing the problem of homelessness. And I disagree with that because it is in the way that we do it. I think one of the most powerful things that In From the Cold has done is it has established relationships between people who are experiencing homelessness and people who are coming from more privileged positions and breaking down that us and them. I remember having a very good conversation with some of the people at St. Stephen's Anglican, who I believe, if I'm not mistaken, that's kind of where In From the Cold originated. They were saying they believe, and I think this is probably very true, that the reason that the 10-year plan to end homelessness was so successful and got so much traction is that In From the Cold had laid the groundwork over many years of building those relationships. So when we started talking about homelessness, so all these people who've already overcome some of the stereotypes and have met and sat down and shared a meal with people in that situation. So I think In From the Cold is a really good example of the kind of work that we need to do. It doesn't on its own solve the problem of homelessness, but it lays a foundation that can overcome some of those root causes. In terms of what more could be done. Some of you may know Paul Bourne from the Tamarack Institute. He shared with me what they've done in their church in Waterloo, which is that they, on a monthly basis, I believe, have a potluck where people, it's not a soup kitchen, it's where people who are in need of food and people who have food come together and share, and there is no distinction between us and them. People just sit down and have a meal together. And anything you can do that can break down that distinction between people and bring us all to a level playing field at the same table, I think, is where we need to start.
Unfortunately, our time has escaped us, and this conversation can certainly continue. There are refreshments. Please stay. But let's thank our panelists for their insightful comments.